Hey, everybody. I am here with Brian Sullivan, the Precise Selling founder. He's written two awesome books, The Precise Leadership. He's written 20 Days at the Top, which I personally had my whole team read. He trained my whole team. He was at our national sales meeting, and he's an ESPN radio host. So, you know, pretty impressive guy. And so when I was thinking about right now, who do we got to talk to figure out how to sell right in this new age of post-COVID life? I couldn't think of anybody better to bring, to give the information to the Floodgate family. So Brian, tell us a little bit about yourself and Precise Selling if you could.
Awesome. All right. Hey, Joe, thanks for having me. And thanks all of you for joining during lunchtime. So a little bit about Precise Selling. So we work with companies, a lot of healthcare companies, but companies in all sorts of industries. And the goal is really simple. It's to create a common sales language for salespeople. And so the three things we focus on is we teach salespeople how to find new customers or steal them from their biggest competitor. Second thing we do is we teach folks is once you have a client, how do you go deeper and wider in an organization? In other words, get more money out of them. And then third, how do you negotiate in a way so you make great margins, right? So it's very tactical how-to sales process. It's not high level, fluffy, cheesy. It's how do we go to work and how do we make sure when we walk in the door and we're sitting in a boardroom and there's three decision makers staring at us in the eye, that our presentation is so much better than the three other guys or girls are going to be coming in behind us. So it's all about how do we make showtime better than everybody. And so that's really our purpose. And you know, it started, I would say it all started back in my Welch Allyn days, right? So I spent 15 years with Welch Allyn and you know, my plan wasn't to become a sales consultant or a sales trainer, sales speaker. And it just kind of morphed into that because the processes we started creating at Welch Allyn just worked. And then it sort of evolved into what became Precise Selling.
That's awesome. That's awesome. Well, you mentioned something about walking in and meeting people, being in the boardroom, kind of a new world, right? So what are some of the habits? And some of them, you know, might be the universal habits that a good, successful salesperson needs in this new world, Brian.
Yeah. So, and you've probably noticed this, Joe, right? I mean, we're on all sorts of virtual meetings. I mean, all
throughout now, right?
Yeah. And what I'm sensing in these virtual meetings is many of us have become very casual, right? Heck, I was on a virtual meeting this morning. Guy had his baseball hat on. The other person's got the dog running in the background. It's just become sort of like chill. And here's my concern. My concern is that we've become a little bit, there's a little lack of discipline. So I believe in what's called work triggers, right? Mm-hmm. One work trigger is to get up at the same time each day. Now, not everyone has been doing that during COVID-19. Again, it's been a little bit lax, right? And so it's so important you set your clock. And just as if you had to drive into work or had to drive out to your sales territory, you got to do the same thing, right? Another big thing is you look at you, Joe, you look handsome as hell right now. You're wearing your, right? You got your
thank you, coat. Sir. I mean, the hair, yes, thank you.
Right? But you're dressed to work, right? And so, and this is something, old buddy of yours and mine, Jerry Ostrom. Remember old Jerry Ostrom?
Oh, of course.
Right? So he was my first manager at Welch Allyn. I'll never forget this. Right. So when I was 21 years old is when I got my first job at Welch Allyn, and they dropped me in the middle of Kansas City. Now, I'm a boy from Connecticut, never been, where the hell is Kansas? Now, I had no manager breathing down my neck every day. So you had to be accountable for yourself. But one of the great pieces of advice Jerry gave me, he said, even if you're going to do an office day, put your suit on. I thought that was madness, right? But it was funny how the days that I did it, I was way more productive. My mind was ready to go to work, right? And so how does that apply to today? Again, I'm on a bunch of these virtual seminars and I'm seeing guys in baseball hats. I'm seeing them all casual. And I'm saying, how can your brain be ready to pick up the phone and make that prospecting call? Or if you've got to deliver a presentation virtually, how can you absolutely be in game time mode when your body is dressed in casual mode, right? So I'm a huge fan of that. Another thing is I believe in a designated work area. Pick your spot, your office. And this also comes in handy with your family, right? If your family knows your designated work spot, maybe they don't come knocking on the door asking you to, you know, fix the faucet. Or, of course, it doesn't work with my wife. But
I've had that problem myself, especially kids.
That's right. All right. Another key thing right now, Joe, we're on LinkedIn. First of all, LinkedIn, in my opinion, is the greatest prospecting tool known to man. You know, it used to be looked at as a resume tool, but right now it's the greatest database of prospects who we can find. Mm-hmm. And so I'm doing a lot of LinkedIn seminars on how to use it as a tool. I encourage all of you folks, do two things now. Beef up your LinkedIn profile. It is your brochure to get your name and your company's name out to the planet, right? And there's so many great LinkedIn resources. And Joe, I know you had somebody on a couple of weeks ago, right, talking about LinkedIn.
Amazing. We've got a ton on our side as well. So we can
Yeah. So a great habit is take 15 minutes a day to do nothing but do an advanced search for people in your industry and connect with them. If you make that a habit, pretty soon you're going to have a whole bunch of connections. And again, the more connections you have, the greater the prospecting tool it will be, right? And then I would say a final thing is, you know, I think we all thought we weren't going to be as busy as we were, right? It's wild how over the past 2 months we're like, oh my gosh, my days are freaking packed, right? But now is an awesome time to study and to learn, right? And so I encourage all my students to take 1 hour each week, put it in your calendar, just like it's a doctor's appointment or going to church or going to work out, and do nothing but study. Don't check email. Don't check voicemail. You might study one of your products that you don't feel real comfortable with. You might join a LinkedIn group and see what people are talking about, right? You may read a trade journal or magazine, but do something to make yourself smarter. If 1 year from now you were 52 hours smarter, the knowledge and skill in your brain, it's like a stock price. It's either rising or it's going down. It is not plateauing, and you control that. And so these are all triggers right now more than ever that I think are real important so that we don't sort of get lazy in this time. Now, Joe, you'd mentioned we're kind of coming out of COVID. And thank God. And I really feel it. And I think our brains right now have to also feel the same thing. But right now, more than ever, it's time to go to work, right? This sort of passive, you know, I don't know if I should call on my clients now. It might be pushy. No, days are over. It's time to go to work.
Awesome. Awesome. So I'm hearing three awesome habits people got to have. One, they got to have the trigger. So they have the schedule, the discipline, the time to get up, the way to dress, the place to be. That's awesome. I totally agree with that. Second, you've got to make sure you're always, you know, sharpening that axe and getting smarter every day. And then finally, spending and holding some time to get connection. Use that LinkedIn, that social media, that big network to expand your network so you have more prospects as you kind of emerge from this thing. Is that right, Brian?
Amen. That's
awesome.
It.
Yeah. Awesome. Hey, one other area I'm hearing a lot of questions about is, you know, you and I, we're sales guys. We'd like to go in the field. We'd like to go meet people, catch a doctor in the hallway, right?
Yep.
We're not doing that. So it's a lot of telephone if you're not social. So what are some of the key habits of cold calls? What tips do you have for someone who, hey, we're not inside. We haven't been inside sales. How do we work this as well as we did this?
Totally. Absolutely. Right. And so I'm going to scare a few of you folks who are watching right now. Right. And here is what you need if you're going to be great at cold calling. A script. Oh, my God. I said it. Oh, right. And now so many experienced salespeople say, Sully, I'm not going to use a script. There's no way. It makes me sound cheesy. And here's what I say. A script only sounds cheesy if you suck at delivering it. Okay?
Yeah.
And so one, Joe, to your point, is because we can't visit people, we have to, outside salespeople now have to become inside salespeople, at least a big chunk of their job. And so if you're one of my students, I would say to you, Joe, right now, okay, I'm going to play the role of a decision maker at a, let's say, an acute care facility, and you're going to pick up the phone. I've never met you. Right. And Joe, you're going to call me and I would ask the question. All right, Joe, I pick up the phone. Go tell me exactly what you're going to say. Now, I'm not calling you out right now, Joe. Right.
Don't do that. I mean,
but when I ask salespeople this, they start freaking out. Well, I would probably just say, you know, hi, you know, my name's Brian Sullivan. I'm with, you know, Precise Selling. And here's the point. They have no clue what's going to come out of their mouth. And you know what that happens? Their body feels pressure. Their voice changes, right? And pressure is what you feel when you don't know what the hell you're going to say. So my point is why don't you think through what would be a great script? In fact, we have a tool at Precise Selling. We call it a sales scripter. So we work with a lot of companies, especially these days, to help them craft these scripts, right? And here's the goal, or here's what's so important being great on the phone. Just be yourself, right? You can't sound salesy. You can't sound cheesy. You've got to be upright, upbeat, right? And you got to show enthusiasm, right? Yeah. So for instance, a simple thing is, so if I call Joe, Joe's a gatekeeper, right? Joe picks up the phone. What should I say? I want you all to write these words down, right? Hello. Hey, I was hoping you could help me. First words out of your mouth to a gatekeeper. I was hoping you could help me. Now that immediately disarms them. It's really hard for people to be jerks when you're asking for help, right? You know, there's going to be one or two out there, but those turn into good sales stories, right? So, hey, I was hoping you could help me. Now, most of your gatekeepers are going to say this. Well, what's this in regards to, right? That's the standard thing. So we know it's coming. Now, the biggest mistake the cold caller makes at this point is they say, well, hey, I was hoping to set up a meeting with Joe McClung. You know, we offer a product that does this, this, this. And so immediately that gatekeeper says, sales call. Let me take your information and I'll pass it out. Instead, what I want each and every one of you to do is take time this week, and I want you to write down what I call a headline, and that's your value prop. So in this case, I might say, hey, I was hoping you could, well, what's this in regards to? Well, we work with companies to blank, 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 and you stop. Now, the gatekeeper's going to go, and now you've got to pause. Don't say a word. And so what it is it's your value proposition you hit them up with, and it can't sound cheesy. It can't sound like it came from a marketing department. It might be like this. Hey, yeah, we work with primary care offices to help them standardize their cleaning and disinfection procedures during COVID-19. Now, Phyllis or Joe at the gate are going to go, well, I should probably put you on to somebody else. And now you get to this next level. So this is just one example of there are real specific cold calling techniques that aren't cheesy. They aren't phony. But I tell you what, you know, my salespeople right now are banging the phones like crazy. They know exactly what's going to come out of their mouth, and they do it enough that it becomes natural. And so yeah. I believe in scripts, Joe.
That's great. And you know what? You can send emails. That's great. But it's easy to delete an email. It's really hard to hang up on somebody. So even though it's the old school way, the phone does make impact.
Totally.
So being prepared for that is important.
Yeah. And to that point too, Joe, there's also a cadence, right? So, you know, a lot of folks will ask, well, when is the best time to place phone calls, right? When should I make my prospecting calls? So throughout the day, let's say 40% of my job today is going to be cold prospect. And that outside rep's going, oh my gosh, that's 40% of my day I don't really like. Well, it doesn't have to suck, right? But a little tip for you, the two best times to make calls throughout the day are between 8 and 9 in the morning and 4 and 5 in the afternoon. The two best days to make those calls are Wednesday and Thursday, right? And so if you're looking for a little tip and you know you're setting prospecting time aside, make those your prospecting hours, make them your prospecting days. And then the other cadence to this, right? When you cold call someone and you get put into voicemail, well, there's also sort of good voicemails that you can leave versus long, winded, boring, cheesy, right? Mm-hmm. You have to create urgency that makes them want to call you back. And then if you leave a voicemail, always follow up with an email, right? Always follow up, specifically after the first call. After the second and third call, I suppose you don't have to send that, but after the fourth one, you do the email. So we have a very specific cadence that we teach our outside or our inside salespeople. Is it foolproof? No. Is it better than most who have no cadence, no plan, and have no clue what's coming out of their mouth? Hell yeah, we'll kill them.
Good. Awesome. No, I agree with that. And one little on the voicemail, taught someone this the other day. Was it a simple thing? The star? And sometimes 3. So I always do *3. It deletes it when you screw up and you get a chance to redo it again. Right. So that's good. All right. Well, hey, the other type of selling out there is obviously a little bit of what we're doing now, right? Which is that virtual presentation, you know, whether that's that webinar, that Zoom call, et cetera. So give me a little bit, what tips do you have for those presentation tips that make the impact?
Yeah. Okay. So you got to romance the room,
Romance.
An example would be, well, let me say this. I want you to treat these virtual presentations like you're walking into a boardroom and your biggest decision makers at your biggest accounts are staring you in the eye, right? So how do you get your body to do this? Now, I think, Joe, you and I will agree, when folks are around us and we're talking and we're seeing body language, and it kind of jazzes us up, right? So there's sort of biofeedback that comes from there's energy that comes off people's bodies. I really believe that, right? Mm-hmm. Now, it's difficult to feel that energy virtually, right? So what I'm seeing way too much of, because I have an opportunity to sit in and coach, just watch a lot of these virtual presentations of my students, my clients. And the biggest thing I see is a lack of energy and enthusiasm.
Yeah.
Right. Which this applies to even real world demos, right? You know, your reps and our reps have gone out in the field and it's like, my God, did you even like what you were talking about? Right. So really, people will say yes to you based more on your attitude and enthusiasm than any content on your boring PowerPoint slide. If they believe that you believe in what you're selling.
Yeah. They get excited. Right? They come along with you. They come along for the journey. Yeah.
Totally. All right. A couple other very specific tips. When should you have your camera up, right? So you're looking at these two pretty little faces here, right? Now,
pretty is exactly what we're going, where we're at, but maybe a few years ago.
You know? Okay. Now, what I used to teach people pre-COVID-19 was always right at the beginning of your presentation, have your face up. Because again, they can see your energy, right? Mm-hmm. And it's something changes right now. It's real hard when you're seeing, like I'm looking at you right now. It'd be really hard for me to kind of be looking away, right? Because it'd be rude. I'd feel like I'd be rude. So put your face up there. Now I used to say, okay, then turn your camera off so they focus on your slides and then come back at the end. But I've changed my mind. Now I believe that you should have your camera up throughout the entire presentation, but only if you know what's going to come out of your mouth, right? Now, I mentioned I believe in scripts, right? Now, I'm not saying every word for word script. Now, what I'll do, because some of the webinars I'll do, there's sections where, you know, I got to read what I wrote down. Well, that camera will go off, and you know what I'll do? They don't see it, and I'm reading from this damn thing, but it's practice, so it sounds normal. They have no clue. They think it's coming right out of my brain. I'm not that smart, right? And so I'm a big fan of keeping that camera. One other key point, this is huge for you salespeople when you're doing a presentation or a demo. If you're making, let's say you're talking about a key benefit of your solution, make sure you finish the sentence with your eye staring at that camera. So for instance, if I said to you, Joe, hey, yeah, Joe, Dr. McClung, thank you. You know, we've got a new sterilization and disinfection program for COVID-19 that's really helping out a lot of offices. And, you know, I think it's gonna keep people safe. Well, I'm not looking at you, right? So it doesn't seem believable. Now, I'm not saying you have to stare at the camera the whole time, but I can promise when I come back, so this program will make your office safe.
I'm already believing it, man.
You're believing it, right?
Yeah, I'm believing it.
So don't do it. And I'm telling you, I'm watching some of these presentations where, again, I was on one yesterday, and the guy is doing a presentation, and he must have had a different monitor over here because he's looking here and he's talking, you know, and I'm just going, holy God, are you on Facebook? What's going on here? Right? The people in front of you are the most important things in the world, and your eyes will tell them if they are or not. Right? So eye contact. A couple more things. Clean your room. Clean your room, right? Make right. That office look great. Joe, you invested lots of money in that big wood paneling behind you.
Exactly. Had to make it look good and professional in there, right? You know?
Yeah. And then ultimately practice. Just keep practicing, right? I mean, we're all going to get better at this virtual stuff. But I would say with no audience, or heck, have your kids or your wife watch you. Click that camera on, click it off, practice. You know, you'll get better at it. You don't have to be a pro right now. You just have to keep getting better.
Yep. And you know what? And one of the other elements I'd love you to talk about is how do they differentiate themselves, right? So, you know, you've mentioned some of those fundamentals, but now they got to make that impact. They got to stand out from the other guys that are getting the virtual training, you know, that are coming in doing it. How does a sales rep today differentiate themselves?
Great one. Okay. In your virtual presentation, I want you to, number one, have a great title slide. Okay, great title slide. Why? Because when I log on, the first thing I see will be your face. Joe looks professional, looks like a guy I do business with. And then my eye turns to the slide. And if the slide is just, some generic, boring, you've got about 15 seconds to make me realize this is, I might enjoy this. I might learn something. So there's a few things you can do, right? You can use numbers to create curiosity. It might be seven ways to give you 3 hours of your week back. Now, if I read something like that, I'd be like, what? All right, 7 ways, 3 hours of my week. All right, now I'll pay attention. So you can use humor. You can use numbers. Do something that creates curiosity. So if you look at your title slide and it's not making you curious, it's not making them curious, right? Mm-hmm. So there's a key point. Next thing I want you to do, start with a story or an anecdote or a case study right off the bat. People will relate more to your stories than, I'm telling you, and even the features and benefits and specs and things that you're going to talk about in your presentation. Talk about how your solution, real world, helped somebody, right? And I'll tell you, it makes you authentic, it makes you real, and it's and no one does it, right? You know, two of the greatest presenters, right? Steve Jobs, Jeff Bezos. What did they do? Well, when Steve Jobs came out with the iPhone, right? He was unbelievable in the stories he would tell. And then also he kept his message very simple. 3 points. 3 points is all they're going to remember on most of your presentations. Keep it simple and keep reiterating those 3 points. If you do those things, I'm telling you, your presentation is going to be worth listening to and people will refer you and people will want to come back and hear you again.
That's really good, because the most default thing people would say, I need to put my company logo on the first slide, or maybe I'll be really fancy and put their logo next to my company logo. But you're right, that's not that exciting, you know? Like, whatever. They need to be drawn in. They've got a choice of emails over here binging or listening. And if you've got that hook, right? This is marketing. You got to get that hook. You bring them in, and then you tell them a story and bring them down the path with you. That's excellent. I mean, instead of thinking presentation, this is selling, right? That's a sales process, man. You know, that's not a PowerPoint presentation.
No. Yeah. In fact, so one of the seminars I deliver a lot is a presentation skills, right? So if you think of what I do for a living, I'm a speaker. Well, I wasn't always a speaker. I had to learn, right? I had to sit in classes. I had to get an acting coach. I had to do all these things, right? The stories was such a huge part of it. And I used to, when I used to speak on selling skills, one of the biggest gifts an acting coach gave me is, I used to tell this story about a proctologist who sat me down after I spewed features and benefits and destroyed this guy, how he grabbed me by the tie. And he said, son, I've looked up more asses than you have hairs on your head. Stop talking. Right. And so now I used to just tell that story. And instead, my acting coach said, act it out. What did the guy look like? And I said, well, his face was like this. What did his voice sound like? Well, he kind of talked like this, right? Now, I'm not saying that in your presentation with a board of executives, you're going to change your face and start doing this, right? But I want you to think creatively, right? If 0 to 10, 0 is boring as hell, 10 is, oh my gosh, this guy's a freak.
Yeah.
Your presentations are about 3.5. I want you to pump it up. You give it a little Billy Mays. Remember Billy Mays? OxyClean.
Oh, yeah.
He drove nuts, right? But he sold more stuff. How did he do it, right? Stories, demos. That guy would be able to take this pen and turn this into the greatest sales demo presentation you'd ever seen in your life. And that's what we have to do. Stories, demos, energy, right? And so those are some of the key tips, I think, that differentiate others.
That's awesome. Hey, one last question for you. You're a man of many hats, you actually have a wearable technology company for a different purpose, finding your kids, right? Which is any father knows that's going to be a problem. Yep. But knowing that space, how do you think that type of remote tracking and technology will impact healthcare, especially in today and the types of products they sell? What's your vision there?
Yeah, well, I mean, so the term these days is, Internet of Things, mm-hmm. connected home, right? Where everything's connected, right? So IoT. So I started this wearable technology company after sitting in a beach chair with about 10 other couples, and one of my buddies lost his 9-year-old daughter for 3 hours. And this is before the Apple Watch existed, right? And so I assembled a team of engineers, and we created what's called KidSport GPS. We were in 2,300 Walmart stores. And so I had to sort of learn. I didn't know anything about the consumer market, et cetera, right? So what we realized is, you know, the evolution of connected things certainly is being played out in healthcare. Everything's connected. But I think, Joe, what you and I are going to see, because we're not going to go to the doctor's office as much, right? We're getting these virtual visits. Soon, you and I are going to be taking our vital signs on our phone. Heck, the Apple Watch already can tell if you have an arrhythmia, right? So I guess what I've learned is all of this IoT is really interesting, how it's changing our world, you know, how it affects, you know, our daily sales process. Who knows? But, you know, to me, technology is making our life easier, and healthcare is taking advantage of it right now.
Yeah. We've already seen some, this was the nudge to accelerate that change, in my opinion. So, hey guys, if you're listening, you probably have some questions you'd like to ask Brian. If you want to put them just in the comments in LinkedIn, you can do that right now. We'll pick some of those up. We do have a couple questions here. So here's a couple I just got over here. What specific things should be included in that sales script? Is there anything really specific that you can quickly highlight, or do they need to go to the overall and download your page and download?
Yeah, you know, what we can do is I've got a PDF mm-hmm. that we give you step by step, right? So we can spend an hour right now talking about it. Right off the bat, it's that greeting that I talked about, right? So you need to know what your greeting's going to be. Again, hello, my name is Brian Sullivan. I was hoping you can help me, right? So there's specific there. Your value prop. You need to know what's going to come out of your mouth there, right? And then there's also something called a takeaway. You know, Joe, I'm not sure if you're the one who's responsible for this, right? So it's called slight indifference. So, yes, there are many steps. I would recommend that you reach out to me at bsullivan@preciseselling.com, and mm-hmm. I will forward you an example of a script that we use every day. Would love to share it. And again, for those, if you're a corporate decision maker and you don't have a script and you need one for your company, we have a whole software tool that helps you create your own scripts. And so,
And we'll download, we'll have that PDF. I'll send it. Anyone that signed up ahead of time for this, we'll push that out to you. We'll also put it on our page so you can find it easily that way. Awesome. All right, we've got another question here is, what's been the best virtual platform you've seen being utilized during this COVID crisis?
Yeah. Okay. So I'm a go-to meeting guy, right? Yeah. I'm doing a lot of my clients use MS Teams. Mm-hmm. I think that's fine for meetings. It's not great for doing like a demo or a virtual presentation, in my opinion. And a lot of folks are in love with Zoom, right? Mm-hmm. I think Zoom's a pretty cool. I love Zoom. I know, Joe, you're a big background guy, right?
Yeah.
Zoom's
right.
Sort of fun because you've got, heck, I got on with a guy last week and, first thing I click on, and he's up in space.
Yeah.
Right? So I'm just everyone. I'm like, what is this? Right. So again, it was sort of an icebreaker. It was kind of cool. It gets us laughing. Right. And he was trying to sell me something. But you know, this little background kind of, you know, it made me say, you know, this guy's a little different.
He took it from one of boring to 10 being crazy. He kind of brought it to that 5 there for you by being in space. Look, right. You know,
it was perfect. And then the follow up presentation he gave me. He was then on a planet. So, of course, first thing I say is, oh, it looks like you arrived. This is fantastic. And again, it broke the ice. So mm-hmm. Zoom allows you to do that. I think it's a really cool tool. But again, on my daily web presentations, I use GoToWebinar or GoToMeeting.
Okay, cool. I don't know if we have any other questions here that come up. We just take the last one here. Is there a presentation template that you use that's helpful, or a template you start with your presentations?
Sure. So again, I've got a PDF that I can send out that has about 10 different things you need to do. For instance, title slide, story, right? Mm-hmm. What your font should be, right? You know, so you're not reading a little of this.
No wingdings?
No. You know, when should you have images, those sort of things. So again, I'd be glad to share it with you, Joe, where you can share it with the folks. Again, we can spend 2 hours talking about the you know, what makes a great presentation. And again, for those of you, okay, if you've got national sales meetings and all these are the sort of things that we teach at national meetings. And again, we're doing a lot of it virtually.
Awesome. Brian, I appreciate it. We finished right on time, which is even better. Look at that. Finished presentation on time.
That's precise, Joe.
That is precise. I love it, man. We got it. So I hope the Floodgate family love this. You gain something from it. If you have other questions, other needs, you know where we are. You know how to reach us. Thank you for your time. Thank you, Brian. I appreciate it.
Hey, bye guys. Bye. Go get them.